think there is someone now who is trying to join. Okay, so we'll give it 2 minutes and then we'll start. Shashank, I hope you are clear with this map reduce, right?
Yes, Ravi. Sorry.
No problem. Today onwards, what we are going to do is that we are going to change the gears. Shashank, please mute yourself. So we are going to change the gears and understand. Is big data and Hadoop contains only the MapReduce and HDFS, or else there are other applications which are attached to this one? In case if there are any other applications, what are attached? What would be our focus on learning those particular things? Is it something that we need to learn all these modules, or else is it something that we want to focus only on some of them? And what exactly are the distributions that are existing? And what are the components of your Hadoop ecosystem? In the moment once you try to take a Hadoop job, okay, what might be the different types of job profiles you'll be looking at in terms of big data? Okay, these are all the things that we need to look at before you really start focusing on this internals of this Hadoop. But one thing what you need to understand is Hadoop, when we say Hadoop, it although it contains only two components, one is HDFS and then MapReduce, there is a lot of story beyond this MapReduce and HDFS. So we'll go ahead and then start looking into these components, and today's agenda is to discuss all those components in detail to make sure that you are aware of those components before we go ahead and then start deep diving into those components also as well. Okay, so guys, one thing I want to ask you, when you are seeing this HDFS or when you are seeing this Hadoop, when you are seeing this, what do you feel? Is it something, it is basically used for your processing data, or else it is a data store, or else it is something like which can be used for your analytical applications and all? What is your perspective on this HDFS and Hadoop? So Divya, can you start giving your insights on this Hadoop and big data? What exactly is this Hadoop? What is your perspective? I understand that you are good at developing Java programs and Core Java and all. Okay, so in case if somebody is asking you to comment something on Hadoop, how do you comment Hadoop?
It is basically used for storing large volumes of data and then processing that data to give predictions.
Okay, so you want to see Hadoop in two things. One is you want to see Hadoop as a storage application, a storage server, as well as you want to see it for the purpose of processing, right?
Yes.
Okay.
We analyze that like once it's processed, we are using the same data for analyzing, and we do the analytics part as well. So I think it's all the three of them.
So you want to use it as a storage, you want to use it for processing as well as you want to use it for analytics. Okay. So Murli and Kamran, what is your view? Thanks, Divya. What is your view, Murli?
It's the same, similar way, like it provides massive storage for any kind of data and enormous processing power. For running applications on clusters of commodity hardware.
Okay. So you want to see only for that particular purpose. Okay. Now, when you see something called as processing, Divya, here, there are two types of processing, a batch process and second thing is a real-time process. Do you know, do
We are
you
using
currently?
Hadoop batch processing, Ravi. Basically, it's on the data which has been previously stored. It's not on real-time data.
Okay, so you want to see in terms of batch processing. Okay,
Yes.
and when you say something called as analytics, when you say something called as analytics, what does it mean? Analytics on the data sets, basically, right? Analytics on the data
Yes.
sets. And see, for the purpose of analytics, we have so many tools in the market, right? You have Business Objects, you have Cognos, MicroStrategy, Tableau, like that. There are so many tools. Okay, is it something? The analytics is something related to that one, or else maybe much more beyond that one that you're talking about. You understand my
I
question?
say something beyond that one
Okay.
because I'm able to use the data to produce something, like even though it's not the real-time data, we can make few predictions, like depending upon the stored one as well. So
Okay, so this is what is called the predictive analytics, the trend analysis, the statistical correlation analysis. These are all the things that we would like to see on this data. Okay, and similarly, there are some more things that are attached here. There are different views. There are a section of people who start seeing Hadoop as a data processing platform. There are some people who can start seeing it is a data storage platform of storing massive amount of data. And there are some people who start seeing this one for the purpose of doing such type of statistical analytics on the data. Those are the three. And there is another category also as well. There are some people who see Hadoop is something which we need to manage. The reason is, whenever you take any data center, the data center will be having some thousands of commodity hardware, as Murali has rightly pointed out, okay, which we need to manage. So what are all the different categories of the people that start seeing this Hadoop is, point number one is, there are developers, okay, there are analysts. You also have something called as data scientists that we call data scientists. Data scientists, you have something called as the admin people that you can have, as well as you also have something called as the architects. So these are all the people who would like to view this Hadoop as a platform in multiple perspectives. Okay, so in such a case, earlier when we are talking about Hadoop, the Hadoop consists of only two things. One is nothing but your HDFS plus what is the other one? MapReduce, right? Contains only two things. One is HDFS along with your MapReduce. So Hadoop is something which is beyond that one also as well. So one thing what we need to have is that when we try to see this Hadoop,
Ravi,
of
are you
course, yes.
sharing your screen?
Yeah, you're not seeing the screen.
No, I'm not able to see the screen.
We are not able to.
I think you are in your own world trying to visualize Hadoop, it seems. That's what I'm seeing. Okay, this is what it is. Hadoop has a storage server processing along with analytics. We talk about Hadoop plus MapReduce, but there are different sections of the people that would like to see this Hadoop in multiple perspectives like this. Okay, so once they start seeing Hadoop in multiple perspectives, we need to start talking about your Hadoop ecosystem. We need to start talking about your Hadoop ecosystem. Okay, so who has joined? Okay, so let me show you something and then we can start seeing this one. See, one thing what we have seen is that traditional data stores are expensive to scale, and by design it is difficult to distribute. That is the reason we came up with scaling the data for this particular purpose. But parallel processing is complicated. That is the reason what we do is that data storage is not trivial. So that's why what is Hadoop here? It is a data distributed storage with computation framework. So Hadoop is not equal to database. That means that we are not talking about Hadoop only in terms of storage. Okay, but this is what is your app store. You can see here, right? Just like the Play Store, you are having Divya. These are all the things that you are having here. Among them, how many things you know? You please tell me. How many things you know? At the max, we know what is HDFS. We know what is MapReduce, right? These are the two things that we know. But these are these many things are there. Okay. But my question to you is that is it something that we need to can anybody identify some of the icons that in this one?
Hive, HBit, Pig, Scoop, Uzi, Cloudera.
Cloudera, what is this Cloudera and what is this Hot Network? What is this Mapper and what is this EMC? And what is this IBM and what is this Intel? And you also have something like, these are all things. What do you call them basically? See, Cloudera, Hot Networks, Mapper, EMC, these are nothing but your distributions of Hadoop, right? Distributions of Hadoop. So what do you mean by these distributions of Hadoop? What we can say is, Apache Hadoop is basically an open source distributed framework that acts as a reference, right? That acts as a reference. Okay, but this is there within your open source network. But in order to make this open source network framework to be taken to the common man, to be taken to the human community, there are so many implementers who have started using this core Hadoop functionality. So for that one, what they have done is that they have built some wrapper classes on top of that. They have built some wrapper classes to that core functionality, and then they have come up with their own customized tools. Okay, for the purpose of distributing this one to, the various sections of the community. Okay, that is a place where these distributions are coming up. So that's why you will talk about common distributions. One is you talk about Cloudera, we talk about Mapper, we talk about EMC. EMC is nothing but your Amazon is there. Amazon, we talk about Hot Networks. These are all the distributions, okay, that are aiming at providing the core functionality of Hadoop to the common public, okay, in order to, by providing some additional functionality also as well, right? Murali, is it clear? What is the purpose of these distributions?
Yeah.
So among them, what are the most popular distributions that you have heard about, Divya? The most popular distributions what you're having here is Cloudera is one thing that is really gaining popularity. And the second thing what you're having here is Hot Networks. These are the two things that are thing. And another thing is that this Cloudera, Hot Networks or EMC, all these three things, what they do is that they try to use the same functionality as it is, which has been provided within the Apache framework libraries. Remember, when you're creating these programs, you specify this one as import org.apache.hadoop.something else you specify, right? So there is a core functionality that has already been provided. Okay, but this mapper, what it has done is that it has considered that Apache framework only as a reference. Apache framework only as a reference, and then what it has done is that they have provided the customized functionality by using those MapReduce algorithms. So that is the reason Mapper is entirely different, and you need to have high intelligent brains in order to work out this Mapper basically. So these are all distributions that we talk about. So that's why I'll just show you the slide. Okay, what exactly are the distributions that you're having here? You see here, the vendor is Hot Networks, we are seeing here, Mapper we have seen, and then IBM InfoSpites, Greenplum Pivotal HD, Amazon EMR, that is Elastic MapReduce, and then Windows Azure Insight. These are all the various distributions that you have. Okay, so the common questions that are asked in the market is, on what basis you are going to take about your distributions? That is something that the guys are going to ask, so you need to be aware of that one. Okay, and what more we talk about here? This is what is your Hadoop store. Okay, but the moment once you go to the next slide, these are all the distributions that we are having here. What is that one here? Cloud Era, Hartner Networks, and Mapper. These are all what are your distributions that we are talking about, right? And the Apache Hadoop, it contains this Hadoop distributed file system, the MapReduce, and the Hadoop ecosystem. This is the place where we are going to talk about. And you guys know the major difference between this MapReduce and YAN, right, guys? Divya, you are clear. Why we are having separate MapReduce and YAN? MapReduce is limited only to the Hadoop 1.0, whereas this Hadoop YAN is something which is coming in the version 2.0, right?
Yes.
So Hadoop distributions comes up with installing business and monitoring support. So that means that if at all, if you want to go ahead and then start building a business relationship with multiple vendors, this is the place where you need to start looking into the Hadoop distributions. Okay, and obviously on top of that one, I want to have the all the types of XYZ functionality that has to be provided. I want to do the visualizations, I want to do the ETL processing, as well as I want to do the reporting, as well as I want to do the analytics out of that one, the near real-time analytics, the visualizations. These are all the things that I want to do. Okay, for that particular purpose, what you have here, you have these applications that are there. We call them as what we can say. You might have heard about Talend, you have heard about Pentaho, you have heard about Plunk. These are all the different ETL functionality or reporting functionality that has been provided. So this is how this Apache Store, what you're having here, has been classified into these multiple sections, basically. Is it clear, Murli, Shashank, and Kamran?
Can you explain the difference between the Hadoop YAN and you're saying the 1.0 version and 2.0? Like, what is the high level difference of this?
See, I'll tell you. You remember, Kamran, I was telling you we are going to have a separate exclusive sessions on Hadoop 2, which is nothing but the YAN. That is a place where we are going to discuss YAN in detail over there. But let me tell you in a very high level way how this is going to be differentiated. What is the core component within your MapReduce 1.0? The job tracker is the core component, right?
Yeah.
What the job tracker has to do? The job tracker has to do the resource management, as well as it is also supposed to do the task monitoring also as well, right? Task scheduling and task monitoring. Like, it need to understand, it need to allocate the resources. It need to find out the place where your data is located, and then it should start assigning the mappers and the task trackers for the purpose of implementing your MapReduce programs. And then it need to also take the heartbeat intervals, heartbeats it need to take in order to make sure that which one is dead and which one is alive, and then it need to process all that one. So in such a case, what happens? Automatically what happens is your job tracker is automatically bundled with a heavy number of operations. Those operations include your scheduling, monitoring, along with your resourcing also as well. Okay, but if a client is requesting a job to be executed to the job tracker, that is one thing. Okay, but how many trackers that need to monitor? Might be in a particular cluster, you can have some thousands of nodes, right? Okay, and in those thousands of nodes, you will have something like what we can say, minimum 20 mappers and 20 trackers are existing. So that means that what will happen here, 40,000 process it need to monitor. Okay, so don't you think that this is going to be a cumbersome task for the job tracker in order to monitor all this particular process, Kamran? Is it not?
Yeah, it is a cumbersome process for the monitoring.
Cumbersome process also as well. And another thing, what type of applications you are doing? Not all the type of applications can be implemented in the form of MapReduce, right? We cannot process all the different types of applications in the form of MapReduce. There might be different types of data, structured, unstructured, along with semi-structured data also as well. And Hadoop MapReduce is suitable only for a particular cream of applications. Okay, so in order to overcome these shortcomings of your MapReduce, what has been done is that the latest version of Hadoop has been released, which is nothing but your YAN, which is nothing but your yet another resource negotiator. That means that to address the shortcomings of your existing MapReduce, this is something which has come into limelight, Kamran. But we'll be discussing them in detail. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
No problem. So this one you are having here. Now in the core Hadoop, when you talk about, we are talking about first things come from, I want to store all my big data. What is that big data? Is nothing but your, there is an app for that one, which is nothing but your HDFS. You all know that one, right, Divya? This is something which you know, this one, HDFS, right?
Yes, sir.
So what is this HDFS? Distributed file system for redundant storage. Okay, designed to reliably store data on commodity hardware, built to accept hardware failures. How it is going to address this hardware failures? In case if a particular node is down, there will be another node which I need to spin up and then start transferring all the data onto that particular process. That's how this Hadoop distributed file system has come up here. Intended for large files, batch inserts. What is this one here? Write once, read many times. That means that you are not supposed to overwrite the data in the case of this Hadoop distributed file system. In case if you want to maintain, if you want to overwrite, what is the option that you can have? You need to maintain one more version of that one. That's what we are going to do in the case of this Hadoop distributed file system. Okay, what is this architecture here? You have this name node, all these things you are going to have, and this is something that you have seen also as well. Okay, data is stored now. Now, how can I create insights of my data? There is a place your where your MapReduce is going to come, right? You have another app which is nothing but your MapReduce. So programming model, is it real-time processing or batch processing, Divya or Shashank?
Batch processing.
It is mainly meant for batch processing, right? Data locality is the king. Execution framework of performing such operations, right? So it has this map and reduce, sufficient shot happens, aggregate intermediate results, and all this blah, blah, blah we have seen. And this is the place where combining and partitioning is going to happen. Now, one thing that we have not seen is we have seen only the basic map reduce. This combining and combiners is something that we have not seen, combining and partitioners. So in the advanced map reduce, we are going to see these particular concepts also as well. Okay. So when you try to combine both your HDFS and map reduce, these are all the things that you are going to have. Okay, now one question to you is, guys, you guys are good at core programming, so that's why you might be liking this Java. I may not be a person who likes Java. Then in such a case, what do you suggest, Divya? What do you suggest in case if I don't like this one? If I don't want to write MapReduce programs, but still I want to analyze the data. So do you have some solutions or you don't have any solutions for that matter, Shashankar, Divya, or Murli, or Kamran?
Yeah, any query language.
What query language?
Any kind of query language, like to extract data and then analyze it. Mm-hmm. And then load it.
But for the purpose of analyzing the data, querying the data, you need to have the relational database, right? Okay. But here, what you're having is you have your data existing in the form of the file system, right? Hadoop distributed file system. We don't have such type of relational concept or tabular concept in the case of HDFS. It is a pakka plain vanilla file system, right? Which is existing in the Linux box. So in such a case, what should we do is the problem. Okay. Now, so this is what we have seen. Now, the thing is that Java for MapReduce is okay. I don't know, dude. I'm more of a scripting guy. What are the scripting languages that you're having? Any idea? Can somebody tell me the scripting languages, what you know, or what are existing in the IT market?
You can, yeah, you can write in the K-shell scripting for doing this job. Like, for example, word count. So you can Python scripting, can do.
Yeah, Python, you can use Ruby, you can use JavaScript, VBScript, and all the scripting languages that we can use. Okay, so for the purpose of supporting scripting languages, okay, who are very much reluctant to code this hardcore MapReduce Java programs, okay, then there is one more app that you are having here. What is the app here? The app is what is called as the Pig. Okay, now the first difference between Pig and MapReduce, I'll tell you. Pig is MapReduce program is expected to take only structured data, okay, but this pig is expected to consume any data that comes in. Pig is expected to consume any data that is expected to come in. What do you mean by that? Any data? It might be a structured data, it might be a semi-structured data, or else it might be a semi-structured data, right? Structured, unstructured, or semi-structured data you should be able to take in. That's why the reason they have named this one as a pig. Generally what happens is that
MapReduce also do the unstructured data. These
semi-structured it will take, unstructured data it doesn't do. Semi-structured data only it will take, unstructured data it will not do. Okay. Now, okay. In such a case, there is one more scripting language that has come up here, and that scripting language is generally treated as pig. Okay, so what is this pig here? It is a high-level data flow language. Data flow language in the sense we'll be dealing in these specific starting from tomorrow. But data flow language means you can have a series of steps that can be written. You can have a series of steps that can be written so that a step referenced by a particular variable can be used in the next step. That is what is called as this data processing language here. Okay, but one thing is that, you know, Apache Pig, what you are having here, cannot directly touch the data that is present in your HDFS. Instead, what it is expected to do is, it is expected to, the pig interpreter, what you are having here, the high level scripting language, what you are writing, which is nothing but the pig Latin script, has to be converted into the MapReduce program. And based on that MapReduce program only, what is going to happen is that the data is going to be ultimately be executed. So that's why your core functionality is going to be addressed as well. Core functionality is HDFS will understand only your MapReduce programs only. So that's why what happens is that you can see here, pig scripting is there. And this particular pig scripting, what it is going to do here, it is going to be converted into your MapReduce distributed framework. And ultimately, it is going to be executed in the form of your HDFS file system. Okay, so for whom this pig is meant for? Pig is not meant for your programming people. Pig is meant for writing the scripting people here. Okay, so we write the scripting, and within this particular scripting, the moment once you start using the interpreter, it will be converted into the map reducing programming framework, and then it is going to be ultimately be executed in this Hadoop distributed file system basically. Okay, so this is how it is going to use. I was telling you, right, it can be used as a data flow language. Why this is called as a data flow language here? This is one variable that I'm using here, Divija. I'm using a particular variable, and then I'm executing a particular statement here. This statement is being used here, right? Is referred with the help of the users. Now what I'm doing here, I'm taking these users and then using in some other variable, some other statement for the purpose of referencing the statement. So is it not something treated as a data flow language here, Divija? Is it not treated as a data flow language here?
Yes, Ravi.
So this is what is a data flow language here. Now tell me, if there is a specific program that is there, just like a word count program or weather climate program or some other program is there. Okay, if I want to write the same program in Pig Latin, or else if I want to write the same thing within MapReduce, the difference, you know, this is going to be the difference. See, if I want to write this particular program here, this is what I'm writing here. How many statements? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 9 statements, I'm able to get the top TRPs of this particular 10 cells. But if I try to write within Java, this is the thing that has to be written. Now tell me, which one is easy? So you're interested to write this Java, or you're interested to write this one, Shashank? Pick.
Yes, obviously Pig Latin scripting.
Yeah, you are interested in Pig Latin scripting or MapReduce?
It's obviously Pig Latin.
So tomorrow onwards, you are not going to touch that MapReduce for sure, right?
It depends because this again gets this is built on top of MapReduce, right? So again, we need to touch MapReduce.
So interpreter is going to take care of converting your pip Latin script into the MapReduce. You don't need to bother.
Okay.
So tomorrow you're not going to ask any questions on MapReduce for sure, right?
Hope so.
Nothing of that sort. The reason is whenever you are seeing the job requirements, they're going to ask you each every nutty gritty details they're going to ask you. So that's why you need to be well versed with MapReduce along with Pig also as well. Okay. But see, and one thing is that Pig Latin is not meant for the core programming people. Pig Latin is basically meant for the developers, okay, who are hesitant and reluctant of writing these MapReduce programs, and then they want to use this particular lightweight things for the purpose of developing these things basically. Okay, so execution plans and all that we'll be seeing tomorrow onwards, but this is what is happening here. Pig seems to be quite useful. Pig is okay. Okay, but what is the drawback with Pig? Even that is also a programming language, right? How many types of application sections we are having here? I can be a programmer, or else I can be a scripting, or else I can be a SQL programmer also as well. Okay, and I'm very much hesitant to write such type of programming language along with the scripting language also as well. Okay, but one thing what I'm interested is, I'm interested to write the SQL. SQL, that means that I'm interested to write only the SQL language. What is the SQL language? Anybody knows Oracle? Or I think you know Oracle, right, Shashank?
Yep, more of SQL.
Yeah, in SQL, what is the major difference between SQL and PSQL? PSQL is procedure oriented, and then SQL, what you're having here, is more of the declarative language, right? Declarative language. What is the declarative language? We specify what has to be done, but we don't specify how it has to be done. Such type of language is a declarative language. Pig is a data flow language. And then MapReduce is a procedural language, right? So if there are some database programmers who would like to still use Hadoop, who would like to still use Hadoop for the purpose of processing your data or for the purpose of storing the data or something of that sort, then in such a case, what happens is we have one more app that is available. What is the tab here? Hey, Pig seems to be quite useful. I'm fine. Okay. But one thing is that I'm more of a SQL person. Then what is that app for that one? What is that one here? That is called as Hive. Hive. So what is the Hive here? It says here. It is nothing but a data warehousing layer on the top of Hadoop. Okay. Allows analysis and queries using a SQL-like language. Hive is best for data analysis with SQL. Who wants to do dynamic query summarization and data analysis basically? So here what you are having here, Pig scripting is there as well as Hive query is there, and then you have this MapReduce, and then you are having this HDFS. So based on this one, what would be the meaningful conclusions that you can draw this? Can you tell me what you can do based on this one?
Basically, we can reduce the usage of MapReduce and more likely use Pig and Hive over MapReduce.
But one thing that you can understand is no matter whether you are using Pig or Hive, ultimately what has to be done, it has to be converted into MapReduce for the purpose of interacting with the HDFS, right? It has to be converted into MapReduce. If you don't have the MapReduce, okay, we cannot have no place of Pig and Hive query also as well. That's what it is trying to tell you. Even when you try go to this diagram also, you'll be able to see at some point the Hadoop ecosystem. See here, this is what is your distributed file system. This is what is your programming model MapReduce. The high level abstractions what you're having here are nothing but your Pig and Hive. Pig and Hive. Okay. So Divya, can you please tell me something about what is Pig and what is Hive, and then why they are used for, and for whom they are not meant for?
If we are a hardcore programmer, we can just go for MapReduce. In any other case, if someone wants to use a scripting language or query language, they can use Pig and Hive respectively.
scripting language they use Pig, and query language they can start using HiWalls
Hi.
As well. Okay.
Yes, it's meant for a different set of people.
Yeah.
Anyone work
sure,
with.
Sure. Yeah. So see here. It is
Ravi, I didn't see the catalog, edge catalog in previous diagram which it shows. Can you move in the same book in the previous page which you show the diagram? Yeah, here is the edge catalog metadata management. But if you go in the book which you show the high level diagram, yeah, where is that?
Hey, this is something more detailed enough here. This is something that is more detailed enough, and this is more of a Hadoop code that has been written in the early ages of Hadoop 2.0. Okay. So that's why the moment once we start going into Hive and Pig, that is the place where they are going to give you the complete details. What is exactly the Hive catalog and Pig over there? Okay.
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 And
this is what
here is saying. Yeah, it's okay. No problem.
Okay. So you understood these two things. Now one more thing. There are some people who are of ETL programmers, right? They are very much interested in migrating the data. They are very much interested in migrating the data from relational databases to Hadoop and from Hadoop to relational databases, right? The reason is, let me tell you, I have the data, I have something like, I'm already using Oracle since long, and within Oracle, I'm having something like 100 terabytes of data, okay? But I don't want to use the normal data warehousing techniques for the purpose of processing. Okay, in turn, what I want to do is that I want to have this data to be migrated into this HDFS. Okay, so for the purpose of doing that one, there is one thing that I have not shown you. This is what is this one. Here, what you're having here is, let me try to decrease this one. This is what is your scoop. Scoop. Why this is called as a scoop is it is nothing but your SQL plus Hadoop. That is the reason it is what is called as the scoop. Okay. So if you want to import and export relational data, if you want to export and export relational data directly into your HDFS storage, this is the place where you can have the option of using this particular scoop. Okay. This is the scoop which is basically used for our batch processing. Scoop is for batch processing, Pig is for batch processing, and Hive is also for online interactive mode, something of that sort. And MapReduce is also basically used for batch processing only. MapReduce is also basically used for batch processing only. So the purpose of this particular scoop is, if we want to export and import, okay, large data sets to and fro from the relational databases into your HDFS, as well as from the HDFS into your relational databases, that is a place where you are expected to use this particular scoop basically. That is the place where you are expected to use this particular scoop. Okay, so if you want to understand this particular scoop, you come here. Where is it? See here, scoop is a connectivity tool for moving data between relational databases and data warehouses and Hadoop. Okay, so for the purpose of moving the data, what you need to have? You need to have the schema, right? Until unless you have the schema or the structure, you will not be able to hold that particular data. So the reason what we need to have is that we need to have these relational schemas, and what is the, when you want to move that many amount of large amount of data, what is required here? Parallelism is also required, right? So scoop is going to use the parallelism concepts of MapReduce and the schema of your databases in order to leverage this particular functionality. Okay, see here, scoop, what it is going to do here, leverages the database to describe the schema from the imported and exported thing, and MapReduce for parallel operation and its fault tolerance. This is what is the scoop that we are going to use here. Okay, but one thing you can see here is, scoop is basically more of a batch type, right? Batch type. But let me tell you one thing. Whenever you are running ETLs, you might have some ETL logs that will be created. Okay. Similarly, whenever you are running your Windows operating system, Don't you think that you'll be having the event log, Murli? You also have this event log, right? When you're working with the Windows operating system, Windows log or event log will be there. Similarly, whenever sensors are generating the data, such type of sensor logs also will be there. Okay, and whenever you are trying to run a cluster of networking system, obviously you will be having those logs that will be generated for each and every data node within that network also as well. Okay, now in such type of logs, please tell me whether your data is generated in a random way or whether your data is generated in a sequential way, streaming way. Let me tell you, if I go to Hadoop, if I go to Yahoo, or else if I go to YouTube and then start typing something and then I want to see a picture. Okay, Bajirao Mastan, I want to see. That is what is an offline mode, right? Okay, but I want to see something called as ABN Live. Okay, when I want to see something called as ABN Live, is it not a streaming of data, Murli? It is a streaming of data, right?
Yeah.
So for such type of streaming of data, which is generated across various nodes within the network, which is generated across various nodes in the network. See here. Flume comes like this. This is the first one. This is your node. This is your node, as well as this is your node. And then these are the multiple independent nodes which are there in the cluster. Okay. And assuming that this node, when it's generating data, okay, so this is node one that you have, as well as this is node two, as well as you have this node three, as well as you have this node four that is there. Okay, and here you have two things here. You have your local file system that exists, and within this local file system, you have your virtual system that else exists here. And this virtual system, assuming that you call this one as HDFS. This is what is your HDFS. Here, what is happening is that all these nodes, what they're doing is that they're trying to generate streams of data here. They're trying to generate streams of data from node one, the data was generated, as well as from node two, the data is generated, as well as from node three, as along with node four, this data is getting generated here. Okay, what I want to do is that I want to cache this data on a streamlining basis, and I want to immediately populate this data into this HDFS. Okay, and you have these particular tools. What are the tools that you can have here? I have the option of using this Pink, or else I can have the option of using your Hive. In Hive, what you can have is that you can have this one as a Hive query language, HQL, what we call here. Okay, I can use this Pink as well as I can use this Hive for the purpose of analyzing this data that is present in this one. This is the place where your Flume is expected to come into the picture. Okay, so Shashank, can you tell me what is the major difference between Scoop and Hive, Scoop and Flume? What is the major difference between Scoop and Flume?
I think Scoop is for batch processing. Constant data and...
Scoop is basically used for moving your large data sets from the relational database into the HDFS, right? That is nothing but an SQL plus Hadoop is nothing but Scoop, right?
Yes, yes.
SQL plus Hadoop is nothing but Scoop. And what is Flume?
What is the Flume is for a data flow or a data stream coming into and falling into a component, and then you if you want to put that into HDFS, then you use Flume.
We want to use this particular Flume. So that means that the data that has been collected from multiple nodes within the network, and in case if the data is coming at a streaming rate, and I want to collect all this particular data, real-time or online data, and then I want to put it into HDFS for the purpose of analyzing, that is the place where Flume is expected to come into the picture. Guys, one thing that if you understand, when you see this diagram, what happens is HDFS is core and then MapReduce is core. And Pig and Hive are basically used for your analytical purposes, right? Pig and Hive are basically used for analytical purposes. And then this Scoop and Flume are nothing but the external interfaces, which are basically aiming at bringing the data from the external sources into this HDFS. Okay. Now please understand one thing. If you guys are aiming at for the purpose of doing your data migration using Hadoop, this is something that you need to focus on Scoop and Flume. Okay, but if your analysis is going to be more of an analytical oriented, where you want to go as a data analyst, the business analyst, or something of that sort, okay, then I suggest you to go with this particular Pig and Hive. Okay, and along with this one, you need to focus on this particular MapReduce also as well. So this is the time where I want you to lock up your requirements in terms of big data. Okay, see, a person who is capable of seeing this entire end-to-end architecture can have the option of trying to scale himself in the case of a big data architect. Okay, but if there are some people who are exclusively working in terms of meeting some of those particular requirements, that is the place where you can lock your horns. I would like to go as a big data analyst, or else I would like to go as a data migration specialist in big data. Accordingly, you can have the option of taking these particular things. Murali, you are clear on what I am talking about?
Yeah, I'm clear.
Which one you want to go?
Not yet decided.
How about you, Kamran?
Tomorrow
I want to go toward the architect, the Hadoop architect.
You want to go as an architect. That means that you want to be a jack of multiple tails and a master of something else.
Master, right? Of, yeah.
Yeah, that's how it has to be done. Okay, now in all these particular things, we have talked about the scripting tool, the SQL tool, the import and export feature of database data along with your log data, something of that sort we have seen. Okay, but one thing that we are missing here is I want to, how many of you know Oracle here? How many of you know Oracle?
I know the PLSQL and queries.
Okay. At least you know Oracle, right? So I have a question here. When I take a database here, let me tell you. When I take a database here, this is what is your Oracle database, right? Okay. This Oracle database, here we are talking about the database objects like tables, views, okay, and other things like procedures, blah blah blah, and functions and all these things we are talking about. Okay. Now the thing is, it also will have a secondary storage where you can have your persistent data also as well. Now, within the hard disk also, is the data going to be stored in the form of tables? Or in what format it is going to be stored? Any idea? Within hard disk, in what format the data is going to be stored? It is going to be stored in the form of data files. It will be in the form of your log files, right? Murali?
Yeah, right. It's not in the form of tables.
It will not be in the form of tables. Table is only the logical representation that we are going to see, right? But ultimately, when it is being stored within the hard disk, the data is ultimately stored in the form of your files only, and those particular files also will have the extensions, right? Files will have the extensions. Okay. And what are the SQL queries that are being filed? What are the SQL queries that I'm writing here? Okay, this SQL queries, what I'm writing here, the SQL queries are being fired against only the tables, right? The SQL queries are being fired against the tables only, not onto this one, right? This is being formed here. So what is this one here? this is nothing but the logical ordination of the data that is present in the form of files only, right, Murali? Logical ordination of the data that is present in the form of files. Now think as the same thing here. Think this one as a HDFS. Think in the form of this one as a HDFS. HDFS files. And this is what is your Hadoop distributed file system, and these are your files. Okay, what are these particular files here? They are nothing but the blocks, right? Each block is a 128 MB or something of that sort. These are your files and these are your log files. Now, I want to view a specific database component on top of this HDFS. The specific database or the data warehouse component, what you can see, and I want to see the data in the form of tables and all those particular things, then what I have is that I have something as a HBS. What is your HBS? Hadoop database is generated as the HBS in this case. Hadoop database is generated as the HBS. Clear, guys? Kamran.
Clear.
Kamran and Shashank, is it clear to you?
Ravi, what is the difference between Hive and HBase?
Hive is a query language. Hive is a query language.
Okay.
HBase is nothing but a NoSQL database. Anybody knows what is the expansion of NoSQL? NoSQL. NoSQL. NoSQL means Yorkan Dilson, eh? What is NoSQL? NoSQL means not only SQL. Not only SQL. Okay. So this HBase is not only meant for storing only your structured data, but it is also meant for storing your unstructured data also as well. Semi-structured data it can store. That is what is called as the NoSQL, and the type of databases what you are having here is nothing but a column-oriented database. Column-oriented database. Is nothing but a column-oriented database. NoSQL is a column-oriented database. Okay, so it is like this. I'm a person who is not meant or intended to see the data in the form of files, but I want to see the data in the form of your HBase. That means that a database built on the top of your Hadoop distributed file system is what is called as your HBase here. Is it clear to you what I'm talking about? HBase.
Yes, Ravi.
Yes. A column-oriented non-SQL database, NoSQL database, built on the top of HDFS. HBase is used to store, read and write large amounts of data. Large amounts of data. Okay, that is what is your database. And here somebody is asking, right? Who is asking? Shashank is asking. In the case of Hive, okay. It uses it, the relational database query language for the purpose of storing the data, Shashank, in the form of tables and all it takes here. But here, what happens is that it is going to use the column-oriented database, and column-oriented database is nothing but a set of all key value pairs that we are going to use. You understand? You know what is a key value pair, right, Shashank?
Yes,
sir. What we are saying, yeah. Produce. So yeah. such a collection of those key value pairs is called as a columnar database in the case of HBase here. That is a major difference. Is a relational SQL is nothing but your Hive. Relational SQL is nothing but your Hive, but this HBase is nothing but a column-oriented database which will have its own set of operators that we use for the purpose of operation or manipulating the data that is present in this HBase. Okay.
Is NoSQL means is that means there is an SQL is involving in this
not
process.
Only SQL, not only SQL.
Yes.
Not only SQL. Yeah.
Yeah. Other thing as well.
Other things also as well. Yes. That's why it is not only meant for to store only the structured data, but is also basically used to maintain the semi-structured data also as well. Semi-structured data.
We'll yeah. Correct.
Those particular concepts. Once we go into the internals of this HBase, we'll be seeing them. Okay. That is another
Yeah,
thing.
I am in the under impression when read NoSQL, that means without SQL. Like you.
No, NoSQL is not only SQL that we generally call about here. Not only SQL. Yeah. Okay. Now, this is what is your HBase. Apart from these things, there are other, these are all your hardcore ecosystem tools, right? But apart from these tools, you also have a couple of tools that you need to work with. One is nothing but your Woozy. Understood is your Zookeeper and a couple of more tools are there. So you can see in this diagram here. Woozy. See, I'll tell you Woozy in a very plain vanilla way. I have one MapReduce program and then I have another MapReduce program and then I have another MapReduce program. Three MapReduce programs are there. Okay. So one MapReduce. Another MapReduce as well as another MapReduce. Okay, so now what happens is this MapReduce is trying to read the data from your input box here. This is what is your input file. File given to this MR1. And reducer is going to this MapReduce is going to produce one output here, right? This is going to produce one output like this. Okay, this is going to act as an input to this one. This is going to act as an input to this one, and this is going to produce one more type of output here. One more type of output in this case here. And what are the output that is being produced? That is being consumed by this particular MapReduce. And finally, what it is doing is that it is also producing one more output like this. It is also producing one more output like this. And another thing is that this one, not only this takes this output, it also takes another file as input here. Another file as input here. This is what is your file two. File two. So in such a case, what you have here, this is going as input here. This is what is your MR1. This is what is your MapReduce 2. This is what is your MapReduce 3. MR3, this is your OP1, output 1. This is what is your output 2. Output 2, and this is what is your FOP, final output like this. Like this, you're hanging here. Now, Shashank, don't you call this one as a workflow? Workflow here? So, and one more thing is that assuming that this file is a time-sensitive file. Time-sensitive file in the sense one output of your MapReduce is going to act as an input with some additional input. And these two things are also going to act as an input for the purpose of loading the data into this final output. This is what is your workflow collaboration program. Okay. For the purpose of kicking off this particular MapReduce and then making sure that the output of one MapReduce is being given as the input of the second MapReduce and subsequent triggering of MapReduce programs till the final output is being given. This is something which is a workflow collaboration program, which is nothing but a workflow collaboration program. That is something that can be achieved with the help of one type of ecosystem tool. One type of ecosystem tool, 1 minute, please. One type of ecosystem tool, and what we do is we call this ecosystem tool as Woozy. We call this one as Woozy. This is what is Woozy that we are going to use here. Woozy is something which is going to do this one. So let me show you what exactly is used here. A scalable workflow system is an integrated into the Hadoop stack and it is used to coordinate the execution of multiple MapReduce jobs. It is capable of managing a significant amount of complexity based on the execution of the external events that include the timing and presence of the required data. What is the timing and presence of the required data? I expect this particular file to be present when this MR2 is going to kick off. Okay, so for such type of complex processing when you want to do, what we generally do is that we generally go with this Woozy process here. Yes, is it clear? Woozy. Shashank, is it clear what is Zuji here?
Yes, Ravi. So does this process happen for a task tracker?
It includes a couple of job trackers and task trackers for the purpose of doing this one. But in YAN, the technology is going to be different. I'll be telling you when we go to YAN also as well.
Okay.
Okay. So these are all the components that you have seen so far. We have seen what is PIG, we have seen what is Hive, we have seen what is HBase, we have seen what is Scoop, we have seen what is Flume, as well as we have seen what is Ouji. Okay. And there are a couple of more components that we need to see. What is a Zookeeper? What is Vir? As well as we need to see what is Mahout, as well as we need to see what is Ambari. There are a couple of more components that we need to see. We'll be starting seeing them eventually. But tomorrow onwards, what I do is that I would like to go with one tool, and the tool is nothing but your, what is the tool that we are going to start here? PIG is the tool that we are going to start, and then we'll take it from there. Okay? PIG. Data analytics tool we have seen. Why? Because so far we started seeing only this MapReduce core programming, but this is the time where we need to get into and then start looking into this thing. So we start looking into and then we'll take it from there. Okay.
PIG we need to install in our system, that is?
Nothing. Everything is installed. No need to worry on those things. Yeah. So we start with the architecture, literature, and all those things we'll see. And we'll see all the couple of things, exercises and all, and we'll take it from there. The level of detail that you have spent with respect to MapReduce, the same level of detail that is going to be spent with respect to PIG, Hive, HBase, Ouji, and along with this Zookeeper, Flume. These are all the same time that is going to take in order to make you comfortable. Okay. So that's it for today, and wish you a good night, and then we'll take it from there, guys. Okay.
Thank you. Have a good night.
Thank you.
Good night. Good night. Good night, Divya.
Good night, Ralph.